Hey guys, welcome to the Smart Venture Podcast. In each episode, we're going to have conversations with some of the top investors, superstar founders, as well as well-known tech company executives in Silicon Valley. We'll have a coffee chat with them to learn their way of thinking and actionable tips on how they build or invest in a successful company. Before we start our show today, I want to make sure the listener, aka you, understand that everything a person say on the podcast only reflects hers or his own opinion, not the show or the company they work at. Our guest today is a chief digital officer at E.L.F. Beauty, where she leveraged cutting-edge technology to help the company maximize growth. In 2019, E.L.F. Beauty closed down all the physical stores and focused on online sales. Now E.L.F. is one of the top Gen Z favorite brands. Prior to E.L.F., she was the director of technology at the James Irvine Foundation, and she led technology in companies in multiple different sectors, such as retail and aerospace. Her name is Ekta Chopra. Welcome to the show, Ekta.
Thank you for having me, Grace. I'm really excited to be part of this.
I have to say, I love the positive energy when you talk. It's so contagious.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. I think, you know, it's a world where you need that positivity. You need to be grateful for and passionate for what you do. So, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. To start off the show, I want to go back to your childhood a little bit. You started out working as a flower girl. Your mom was a really cool entrepreneur person. You are really looking up to her. You started working when you were 11 years old. You started your actual career in IT. And now you're the chief digital officer at E.L.F. I would love to learn more about from your perspective on how you grew up and how you got to where you are today.
Yeah, no, my mom is a big influence in my life. And growing up, you know, my mom always instilled in me that always think of, you know, put yourself in other people's shoes, because it's so important to lead with empathy and not always, even though we had everything, she would always like tell me that even though you have everything doesn't mean everybody else does. So that instilled in me this concept of empathy. So as I grew up, you know, my life happens, right? Like working at 11 is not anybody's choice. It was out of like this thing of helping my mom. We went through a shift in our financial situation. And when I saw that my mom was working really hard and I had young brother and sister, for me, it became, I need to do something to play my role. And I think that helped, that sort of continued with me. I became head of household for a while and so forth now. And I think it was also sort of, you know, it gave me this drive to do something better and always sort of strive for more. And education was a big part of that, because education was the only way I could get myself out of a situation that I didn't want to be in, you know? So I think that's like sort of my journey has been about these values that my mom instilled in me as a child, but then also then me sort of having this curiosity and this drive and this conviction that I can do anything, that there's nothing out there that I cannot conquer. You know?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like you're so positive. Your colleagues, there are comments like you're the biggest cheerleader. You're this really super performer. Where does this positivity come from? You mentioned your mom is a good role model and then you had to work early on, but how do you keep being so positive and self-motivating?
Yeah, I think there's so much to be grateful in life. And if anybody after last year doesn't think that, that is still living and breathing, they really need to reflect. And I think positivity in life comes from, once again, my mom. My mom always told me that, you know, there's good days, there's bad days, and never overreact on either the good days or the bad days, because time is constantly changing. So how do you use your energy to be, you know, more positive, that every, no matter what, it's all going to be okay. It's all going to be okay. You know, you can have a bad day, but you're also going to have a good day. So it's going to be okay. And that's what I tell my daughter too. It's like, you know, she'll come out of her classes sometimes and something's not working. I'm like, it's all right. You know, it's all right. You know, and it's sort of just focusing on the good, and it's focusing on what you are grateful for.
Yeah. I also saw the letter you wrote to your daughter, and that was a good one. So much positivity. I don't know how old she is. You know,
She's
6 years old.
Oh, 6 years old. Oh, that's awesome. Oh my God. That's the cutest age.
It is.
Not until she got to the teenager phase. I'm just kidding.
Then I might feel differently, but yeah, she's the positive light in my world. So
yeah, totally. Going back to your career, you are currently the chief digital officer at E.L.F., but your actual career started as working in IT at an aerospace company, and you came quite far. When it comes to career decisions, who do you consult your career decisions with? Who do you surround yourself with? And who is on your personal board of advisors when it comes to career decisions?
Yeah, I think there's many, you know, throughout my journey, there has been a lot of people who've played a major role in my career. I'll start with one is, of course, my mom. She's my best friend. I am very, very close to her. I think the second person who really helped me go from being a, you know, just a good leader to like from good to great was one of the CIOs at Charming Charlie, which is another company that I worked
The fashion company.
Yeah, the fashion company. And he actually made me a much better leader. And I went through this sort of, you know, course of looking. It's like, it's called the it's like a looking glass class. It's a creative leadership, sort of a program where I learned that my strengths were also my weaknesses, and I needed to know how to balance them at different times. So that was like a really big pivot in my career. And I think the second person was another one of my, bosses was at the Irvine Foundation. And I felt that's where I learned that it's great to be, you know, you're so good at what you do, but then how do you also instill like this impact and this community and this purpose into what you do? Because that can also giving back to the society and so forth. That also made me a more holistic leader. You know, I would say that I knew that what I was doing was not just impacting the company, but the broader world as well. And how do I do a better job at that? I would say currently, you know, there's my CEO, he's my biggest cheerleader, my CMO, Corey, who's like this lightning bolt. And throughout my journey, like there's people who are never going to change. Like I'll always reach out to them, but I've always built great relationship with my bosses, and other people that I learn from. And they might not be bosses. They might be someone, you know, who's like really great at something. And I'm like, I want to learn that skill. You know, how do I get better at that? So I would say that my personal board of directors, I would say every time there's about 5 of them that either I am truly, truly inspired by, or they're doing something really amazing, or they can make me a better leader and give me this, you know, time that, you know, that they can sort of spend with me to sort of have a discussion and give me feedback. And the other has been sort of my mom, who's been sort of like this constant in my life.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's super cool. Like, I definitely feel like parents or family are like definitely the foundation of whatever you do, no matter if it's career or like your life journey, they're always there. And you mentioned about one of your leaders at Charming Charlie, he shaped you into the leader you are today. There's two parts of the question. One part is, how do you build that relationship with that person to make them pay attention to you and then like actually want to work with you? What are some strategy that he helped you to grow as a leader?
Yeah. I think number one is, you know, reflect in the mirror and be honest with yourself, because I do think having self-awareness is very, very important. Knowing that what you're really, really, what your strengths are and what are the things that you're, you know, you still need to work on. If you're not honest about that, you cannot grow. So I think that's the one thing that I've always been, is I'm very open to feedback. I'm very open to, you know, learning a new way of doing something. I'm very open, being really comfortable, you know, comfortable with sort of ambiguity and doing something you're like, oh, that's scary. Do something that's scary, because that's going to, you know, really sort of open up the door. So to build that relationship, I would say there's a couple of things. One is, you know, when I first met him and he was coming in, I was very, very much about like, here's sort of my where I see I can be very, very helpful. These are like things I could do with my eyes closed. Here are things that I'm still working on and having that honest discussion. And here's the things that I just have this desire and this curiosity to learn, you know? And then sort of once we did that, I think he felt that I was someone who was okay with being, you know, giving feedback. I was good with, you know, things like that. And that just sort of, then it was a relationship that we just, you know, harnessed, I think. So,
yeah, absolutely. I think understand yourself, knowing who you are is just so important in business or in life. I definitely feel like you hit the point there. In terms of developing your skills, we talk about the leadership side. Is there some skill that you're constantly trying to learn and get better at? It could be like soft skill, like sales or communications, or technical skill, like coding, or what would you think it's like one of the core skill that
I would say I'm a lifelong learner. So each year I take 2 courses in something that I want to get deeper into. So I take out time for that. My husband, who's my best friend, he knows it that I'm going to spend this time, and he just has to, he's got the ball to help with my daughter. So last year I went deeper into digital media and digital marketing. I went deeper into security because there's so many different changes. This year I went deeper into data science. So I'm taking currently a course in Harvard Executive on data science and so forth. And then the second one, which is going to be in June, is around leading with finance. When you become, when you transform from being just a functional leader to a business leader, you have to understand P&Ls. You have to understand some of the things that you, you know, make up the business, I guess, you know, the mechanisms, right? Like the P&L, the balance sheet, and what the business drivers are, what are investors looking for? So this year I'm focusing on going deeper into leading with finance. So for me, it's like, I always recognize where I have to get better, and I need to, it's not just by doing it, but understanding the fundamentals. So yes, I did that in college, but fast forward, it's not a muscle that I'm, now I know more. So if I go back to the, you know, fundamentals, maybe I can even excel further, you know? So I'm constantly looking at ways of improving my knowledge.
So learning itself is something that you're constantly learning.
I'm constantly learning. For me, that's like so, so important. Constantly learn. Learn from others.
Yeah, I feel you. When it comes to acquire this knowledge, besides going to executive education programs, what are some other channels you would use to learn about new things?
Yeah, I allocate, especially last year, you know, as lines blurred between going to work and coming back, I allocate a good an hour every day, scattered throughout the day, because it's hard to dedicate one full hour, just reading about things that I'm interested in. Right now, my passion is NFTs. Like, I'm reading about NFTs. I'm learning about NFTs. And I'm like, how can I just build one to understand the mechanism? You know, I'm very curious from that nature. Like, you know, I like to read what's happening. It could be general around, you know, what's happening with the global supply chain, right? Like, why are there delays and the all of that stuff? Or I'll pick a topic around, what are other retailers doing? I'm a big fan of L'Oreal's CDO, right? Like, I follow her. So she did a masterclass on something. So I'm looking at that. So for me, it's like, how do I learn from these geniuses, as well as what's happening around the world? Because it's knowledge that then I can, you know, also sort of, you know, hone in on or do something with, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I love that. I feel like just constantly learning is definitely the part that you should be doing. And like, I'm so fascinated. And then I was actually listening to NFTs yesterday, and I was listening to the Andreessen Horowitz podcast on NFTs. I will be honest, like, I do not understand what's going on, but like, I'm just like trying to absorb as much as possible.
It's a fascinating world. I mean, it doesn't mean that I'm now going to be a master at it. Mm-hmm. But understanding the fundamentals just, you know, helps me know a little bit more about the future, because there is a lot of things in there that are going to be part of the future, you know?
Yeah. Speaking of the future. So in 2019, E.L.F. closed down all the stores, right? And then you guys shift all digital. I thought that was such a bold move. Yeah. And as the chief digital officer, what was your role in that? How did you help the company pivot into an all online business?
Yeah. So, you know, when I first joined E.L.F., I was brought in as a technology leader, right? Someone who knew how to sort of quickly put together a strategy. They wanted to go public in September. How am I going to build these blocks that help us, you know, be strengthened from a going public perspective? 2017 became around strengthening the foundation, the plumbing, fix the plumbing, how we serve our customers, and then how we serve our consumers. Through that process, I learned, you know, our plumbing was really weak, and which meant that we had to have more investment and more dollars, and dollars and resources are finite. So as, you know, the company was deciding, hey, digital is a real thing. Digital has evolved from being just e-commerce to like this ecosystem that you have to build. It was just about education. It was telling them that, hey, we really need to change our platforms. We really need to change our thinking, our organization skill set, and so forth. And it was a, as I said, like, I'm so proud to work for a company that is a digital native and understands the value. And I have, we have leaders that are not just talking about it, they're actually doing it. So I think my role was around education, building a plan, and actually executing at E.L.F. speed, what we call our E.L.F. speed. We move very, very fast.
When you guys transform from offline to a digital first business, there were three key points, right? The first touch point, creating digital ecosystem, and to make it digital first, you need to focus on the customer and be future proof. Those are great keywords. How do you guys implement those key points into the business? Also, I have some friends who started Shopify stores, someone on Shark Tank. What's the difference between if I start a cosmetic Shopify store compared to E.L.F. transform its offline empire to an online empire? What are some actions you guys took to make the transition happen?
Yeah, great question. And I think first it starts with, once again, you have to have a strong foundation. If you can have all these great ideas and, you know, implement like the buzzwords, personalization, consumer experience, like all of that stuff. But if your foundation is not right, you can't do it. And foundation means your technology platform, the people, the skill set that you need, as well as surrounding yourself with the partners that know, you know, can augment some of that knowledge. So it started with making sure that number one, everything starts with a good product. We know our products are great. E.L.F. is for every eye, lip, and face, and we actually provide quality products. So we know our products are good. We know our community loves us. They tell us when they don't, when they're upset, they're mad, when they're happy, they're engaging with us. So, you know, those are check, check, check. But then the second is, okay, now, you know, I don't care where my consumer goes, right? I don't care where they shop, but my site needs to be the authority when it comes to education, when it comes to building a relationship with the consumer. In order to do that, my platform needs to be solid. So I knew that the platform needed to be solid. Then it was about building a relationship with the consumer. How do you do that? Through an awesome loyalty program. So you get to, you know the consumer at a deeper level. Then it's about, okay, they trusted you with their data. What do you do? Personalize their experience, right? Like if personalization is not about a technology, it's about the content, the copy, the messaging, how you send them, you know, an email or a text at what time, you know, things like that, right? So then came the personalization. All of this stuff gives you a lot of insights. Data is the fuel for your digital, you know, ecosystem. So getting those insights and actioning against them is another thing. That get ready to do that. Love data. You know, you need to have a deeper relationship with that data if you want to succeed. So currently, a lot of, you know, small businesses, big businesses are experiencing brand new consumers to their brand. People who never shopped online before. But you won't be able to retain them unless you have a strategy to engage them and, you know, and so forth. So that's what my thing to people is, start with your foundation, have the right skill set and surround yourself with those superpowers that you need to accelerate and then fall in love with data because data is your best friend when it comes to digital.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm curious, E.L.F. is the top two Gen Z favorite brand.
Yeah.
And you guys did so many really cool collaborations. I really want to get myself the Chipotle Pilot because I normally shop in Target for the E.L.F. products. And I need to get myself that. I feel like those are just so cool. The collaborations. Yeah. And then you guys did the new line with Alicia Keys and the Clean Beauty skincare line. Those collaborations are extremely cool. What was the philosophy behind it for the listeners who owns their own business? How can they learn from you guys to adapt the thinking behind these moves to their own businesses?
Yeah. I mean, I think number one, I would say is everything that we do is based off an insight. So if I just think about Chipotle, it was based on an insight. And the insight was, you know, when consumers actually walk into a Chipotle and they look at that bar, the lettuce, the pinto beans, and all of that stuff, it reminds them of an eyeshadow palette. So that insight led into, wow, that is so cool. Like, that is very interesting. So then, you know, through connection, you know, getting in front of the CMO or the digital officer at Chipotle, the CMO and the brand teams and all of them, then it was like, wow, this is very interesting. And when we look at all our brand values, right, we were so aligned as well. So I think it was about like everything starts for us with an insight. Now, if I look at Well People, why did we acquire Well People? They have the same renegade spirit as us. They started with they were in clean beauty before clean beauty became cool, right? So having those renegade founders who do amazing things, and it just made sense to like bring them into our portfolio. And Alicia Keys, she's a goddess. Like, who does not love Alicia Keys? She's a goddess. And I think, you know, when we thought about doing something really amazing with beauty, where it was content to commerce, it was more about a lifestyle beauty brand, then Alicia Keys was the only name that kept on coming up as someone who's not this, you know, a celebrity that's extreme, you know, behavior. She's doing so much good for the community, for the society. And she just fit perfectly in our values and so forth. And it was just a connection, this magic, a very first time. So once again, everything starts with an insight for us. And it's important that whoever we bring into our ecosystem or we go out and partner with, that we are like-minded people, because you know, we move at crazy speed. We like to test and learn. We take risks, but not everybody does that. Right. And so that those are some of the things.
Yeah. You guys did so many really cool collaborations. For example, the brand with Alicia Keys, the collaboration this week with Jan Atkin, and there is the Clean Beauty line. Those are all really cool collaborations, great extension of the original E.L.F. brand. From browsing on LinkedIn, seems like the executive team are coming from some big corporations. They are more towards the experienced senior level execs. Since a lot of the collaborations are really Gen Z friendly, you guys are great at reaching the audience. How do you guys understand the Gen Z market really well? How do you study the group that you're targeting?
Yeah, great question. And I think what I'll say there is that, you know, testing and learning has to be part of your DNA, because you're not always going to be, you're not always going to know everything. So testing and learning and being comfortable with ambiguity is really important. So if I think of TikTok, we are the TikTok billionaire, where we did amazing with our first eyes, lips campaign, face campaign. And it started with a very, very small test and learn, which led us to believe that we needed to invest more. But then TikTok is not, it was so new at that time. Then it was like, we don't know everything. So we partnered with, you know, movers and shakers who are great partners for us to say, mm-hmm. hey, we don't know anything about TikTok. Teach us. So then we partnered with the experts to do that, right? So mm-hmm. they helped us create the strategy and then help us like do it right. And then mm-hmm. we gave them the freedom to like really, you know, sort of take it to make it authentic to that channel. Mm-hmm. So I think it all starts with, I'll go back to, you don't know everything. Be comfortable mm-hmm. with partnering with people who know this better than you. Then, mm-hmm. then the second is, you know, then you have to sort of every channel, every consumer segment is different. Then how do you shape yourself, shape shift in a way that is very relevant to that channel and mm-hmm. to that consumer? So mm-hmm. I think those are some of the things that you have to get comfortable with, because what works in Instagram doesn't work in Facebook. What works in Facebook doesn't work in TikTok. So how do you like change those different personas, those mm-hmm. different content, the messaging and things like that?
Absolutely. That's so cool that you guys doubled down on TikTok before everyone else did. When it comes to collaborating with movers and shakers, how do you pick which influencer to work with? Let's say you and I are selling t-shirts. Should we pick the most followed people in the category, or should we pick the fans first? How should we implement the TikTok strategy?
Yeah, good question. And I think, you know, of course you have the biggest influencers now on TikTok, but then there's also these micro influencers. Mm-hmm. There's up and coming, and it's part of E.L.F's DNA mm-hmm. and our purpose-driven stuff is that we're not always going to be with the most famous person. We're going to mm-hmm. create the famous people, right? Mm-hmm. We want to support the up and coming, influencers as well. And we did that through our Eyes Lips Famous campaign as well, where we paired like the famous people with people who are just up and coming, and they mm-hmm. gave them an opportunity to grow their audience. So I think mm-hmm. we do have a very tiered approach to influencers. Jen mm-hmm. Atkins is a rock star. She's like one of the biggest mm-hmm. influencers. So maybe we do something that's, and we did a very purpose-driven, very much a campaign that was authentic to her and authentic mm-hmm. to us. But then we also have, you know, those other influencers that might not be very well known, but we know that they love E.L.F. They're part of our community. So we harness those relationships in different ways. You mm-hmm. can't have one cookie cutter approach, but you do want to diversify your portfolio to have micro, macro, mm-hmm. you know, those super mega influencers. And I think that's the right way to kind of think about it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think diversification is definitely extremely important when it comes to this. And when it comes to judging how well your campaign is performing, what would be the numbers or like something yeah. that you guys are looking at?
So there's like different things. So like if you think about metrics are different for each tier. So mm-hmm. maybe, you know, some influencers that we spend a lot of money and then we do like a collaboration, mm-hmm. then of course there's expected, and let's say Target is involved or other, you know, because now that product is actually going to go at a retailer or we're going to mm-hmm. sell on the site. Then of course you have financial metrics, like how many mm-hmm. do you build? What is your return on investment that you want? How much, you know, does it cost to do this type of a collaboration, and what should be our ROI? But then there's a smaller, you know, where you're not building a product. It's more mm-hmm. reach, right? More audience. Mm-hmm. It's more, you know, sort of did that influencer help us get into a new segment? Did mm-hmm. that influencer help us create some buzz, you know, mm-hmm. or anything like that? So I think it's different for each tier. Mm-hmm. So I think that's where we don't do a lot of big collaborations, mm-hmm. but, you know, our Jeffree Star, like he mm-hmm. likes our product or he ranks our product. We never paid him for it. Like it just mm-hmm. is very organic. So some of them, you know, come to us or do that in a very organic way as well. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, absolutely. You mentioned about E.L.F. speed early on. I know mm-hmm. that you guys are famous for making decisions really fast. You guys decided to go on TikTok within minutes. The decision was made. Yeah. And as you guys like are all coming from really big corporations, how do you make the speed happen? Because yeah. of corporate DNA was more like, oh, let's talk to 40 stakeholders, that type of thing. Yeah. But it doesn't seem like it's happening at E.L.F. at all. So
yeah. There's no red tape. I think You know, one of the things that I really like, E.L.F. is the best place I've ever worked at. I feel so empowered when I come into work. There hasn't ever been a red tape. So I think it starts with having such an amazing leadership that creates and fosters that type of culture. And it starts mm-hmm. with our CEO, who's so transparent and just like so much. A lot of that speed culture comes from him. It's like, oh, you want to do it? Go do it. You know, what's mm-hmm. the worst? Like, you know, obviously there's like big risks, small risks and so forth. But I think that's what I love about the E.L.F. culture. And I think there is no red tape, as I said, but it's also when you hire good people, get out of mm-hmm. their way, because you hired them for a reason. You hired them for a purpose. And, mm-hmm. you know, and some people are going to, some of the bets might be not as good and some bets might be really, really good. And, but allowing that freedom, mm-hmm. as well as sort of this culture, which allows you to make mistakes, I think is important. The second piece is there's so many people who've come from big companies to E.L.F. and they're like, wow, E.L.F. is the best place we worked at because we never thought we could do this, right? Like they're doing stuff that they've never done before. So I think it's also like we create this culture that I would say is different than what they've seen at bigger corporations. It's allowing for that agility and that freedom and that transparency that's needed.
Yeah, I'm really amazed by E.L.F. I believe it's a 2004 brand, right? Like it's been a while. When I was in college, I already shopped for E.L.F. Beauty. I was like doing the Christmas stuffer for my roommates in college. That was when I first purchased like the E.L.F. product. And now it's been a while, and like you guys stayed really relevant, and then now you guys are dominating the Gen Z trends. And how do you guys stay really on top of people's mind when this many years has came back? Also, how do you decide Gen Z as who you're gonna go after? Because that's like a really challenging market for a brand that's not born in 2020.
And I would say it's Our core fundamental, E.L.F. is for every eye, lip, and face. So we mm-hmm. do try to serve everyone. I think how do we stay fresh? It mm-hmm. comes down to this ecosystem of and the spirit that we've built that, yes, there is, we are always staying true to our values, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. But we always have our eye out for what's up and coming. So we're mm-hmm. always, our head is always in the stars. Oh my God, TikTok. Okay, let's do a test. Thriller, let's do a test. Clubhouse, mm-hmm. let's get there. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about stuff. Or, whatever, augmented reality or virtual, anything like that, or Twitch. Mm-hmm. So I think we always stay true to our values. Mm-hmm. We try to serve everyone, but then we're always looking for those new frontiers that are going to help us gain this new knowledge and inform our strategy. And the thing that always remains constant is E.L.F. speed. We do it faster than anyone. Why? Because that's the only way to stay on top. And which means that it might not be the perfect, thing going on, but you're constantly improving it along the way.
So true. That is so true. Staying on top of the game by trying new things constantly. Yeah. And that's such a good takeaway.
Yeah.
Going back to your own experience, you have worked in many different sectors. You worked at aerospace, private equity, foundation, and fashion company, and then now beauty company. As a chief digital officer or working in IT, what is the similarity and differences running these companies?
Yeah. I think domain knowledge was helpful, like when I was working at different companies. But one mm-hmm. thing is always sort of that has been constant when I was in technology was people were facing the same challenges. You have your plumbing, which is your infrastructure, which is really mm-hmm. important. Then you have these company strategies and initiatives, whether it be going global, going this and mm-hmm. doing, I want to be public. I want to be sold to a bigger company. So mm-hmm. you took those things and you informed, all right, how am I going to build the strategy for this company, mm-hmm. in a way, right? But mm-hmm. it was always the same thing. It's the foundation. It's setting them up for scale. It's getting them ready to, from a security perspective, for going public or whatever that might be. So there's obviously four or five things that have been very constant. And I think in my journey personally, because I'm sort of a person who likes to move really fast, mm-hmm. what I think helped me is that I do like to do things really quickly. And mm-hmm. especially with high growth companies, because it's so fun. It's so complex. And it's mm-hmm. like, you learn so much. And I think that knowledge also helped me in my mm-hmm. journey to being comfortable with being, you know, going fast, making mistakes, but getting ready and having a plan to pivot as quickly as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. When it comes to your own career journey, how do you pick what your next role is going to be in the past? What characteristics do you look for in jobs when you were in your 20s?
I think earlier on, it was, you know, my first tech job I got mm-hmm. because I was an accounting manager at mm-hmm. like this, you know, sort of software firm. And I saw like all these guys in the back doing programming. I was like, okay, why I can do that, right? Like, what do I need to do that, right? So I started like going after work and looking at what they were doing, talking mm-hmm. to them, learning about how they got into their career. So it started with curiosity. Then I was like, okay, mm-hmm. I can't afford a $4,000 Microsoft certification. I'm going to do it on my own. So going to Fry's, buying parts, breaking computers, fixing them, connecting them to networks and learning. And then my first job was all about, please hire me. If you don't think I can learn in 30 days, fire me. It was like putting myself out there at the aerospace company. And mm-hmm. this person gave me my first opportunity on the fact that I was very authentic about, I don't know this, but I know I can do it. And in 30 days, if you don't see the spark in me or I don't execute, then, you know, you can find another role. So for me, it's always been about, you know, learning, constant learning, getting better. And when I look for my new roles as well, it's usually I haven't really looked. People have sort of, you know, reached out, which has mm-hmm. been, I'm really grateful for that. But it's about the culture of the company. Does it, you know, it's really important for me to wake up every morning and love what I do. Am I happy? Mm-hmm. Because you only have one life to live. And if, you're gonna be, if it's only about the money, then go find something else. For me, it's like, does it fulfill me? You know,
yeah,
and
yeah.
Elf fulfills me. All my jobs have always fulfilled me. So
yeah, totally. I love that. I feel like your energy is so good. I wish, I hope, like, I don't know, like, you know, a couple years later, I could still like you're on your level of and like energeticness and like so positive. I really love that. So as a chief digital officer at E.L.F, how do you set KPIs for yourself? Yeah. You already made it to the top. What's your goal?
Yeah.
Your own job. And then like, how do you evaluate, oh, if I'm doing good or not? Each quarter.
So almost 12 years ago, and it's funny you asked that because I just had a leadership team meeting with my digital team yesterday. And I gave them an exercise. I gave them an exercise of like, what is the vision for yourself, right? Mm-hmm. And I wrote somebody very close to me 12 years ago, I walked into their office and I saw this, you know, sort of a vision statement for themselves. Mm-hmm. What am I going to conquer? Like, what is my vision 20 years from now? What am I going to do 1 year from now, 5 years, 10 years from now? Mm-hmm. I was so inspired that I wrote my own vision statement. So now what I do is every year I look at those goals. Did I actually, you know, read 50 books that I thought I was going to read? Did I actually walk as much as I wanted to? Did I exercise? Did I learn a new skill? So I really track my progress against my career, my life, my family, you know? So for me, it's like they all need to be balanced and for me to, you know, be happy. So I track that. I have a vision statement for myself and I always try to measure myself. How am I learning? Did somebody inspire me to even add another goal to my list?
Yeah. Wow. I think that's really advanced thinking. I feel like that's really Gen Z because in the past, like in my generation, I'm in the 20s, people my age were like really promoting the hustle spirit. But now Gen Z are really like, am I doing well for myself? Like, am I happy? That's a really forward thinking. And that, I think that's so good to like even set goals for that specifically to kind of evaluate based on that standard than the traditional, like the money or like the power or whatever.
Money will come. Like if you're doing well, money will come. I'm not saying, you know, don't be, because you know, I don't want to be encumbered by financial burdens, right? Mm-hmm. So I do want to be able to enjoy my life in the future, but at the same token, not at the cost of being miserable. I don't want to. I want to lead a life where when I come home and I spend time with my daughter, I'm smiling mm-hmm. and not, you know, burdened by what has happened at work and so forth. So.
Yeah, totally. I feel you. One of the challenges you've mentioned in the past was back in time, TikTok and other social media strategy were nice to have, but now it became a table stake. Everyone's trying to take their business fully online, capitalize on the trend as well. What's your plan on keep building E.L.F. as the digital leading brand?
Yeah, I think it's no different than what I said. Like, of course, you have to have a solid foundation. But then you're always on the lookout for and being comfortable with trying and doing new things. So mm-hmm. yes, AR, AI, personalization, all these buzzwords are very, very, they're table stakes. So if you're not thinking doing them right now, you might as well shut down your business. Right? And so you have to start thinking about it depending on your category. But right. I think it's also, you know, not like, oh, I don't want to be on Twitch right now because it's just like, maybe it's like a fad or a bubble. Well, become mm-hmm. part of the bubble in a small way, you know, to yeah. see if it really is or not, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think that's the thing that is like always looking out for those opportunities, you know, where mm-hmm. people are doing great stuff. And also we don't know everything. So one of the things that I love is that we instill like a masterclass, you know, that we have outside speakers come in and talk about different things, diversity and inclusion, or, you know, new things that are happening, mm-hmm. data insights, all of this stuff. So we're always learning about and keeping our eye out on new trends or things that we should do mm-hmm. from a purpose, from a brand purpose. So I would say it's a constant journey. It never stops.
Yeah, totally. I love that. E.L.F. is a business. That means you have to make decisions based on the money that will be generated from a business decision. Sometimes social media can take a long time to see results. How do you quickly evaluate if something like TikTok is worth doing?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, we once TikTok was an example where we just spent a little bit just to see. And we saw that, hey, people were very engaged. We saw the reach that we wanted to. Now we're going to go big. So it's all about testing, learning, but evaluating if you're going to do it or not. And some of it, you know, giving it enough time too, because some of this mm-hmm. does take time. So I would say always start small if you don't know. Mm-hmm. Partner with someone that actually knows about that channel mm-hmm. or that, you know, because it never hurts to mm-hmm. learn from others. And then if it works, move quickly and make the bigger bet, you know, because you mm-hmm. want to be the first one making that bet. So
yeah, for sure. I think for E.L.F., E.L.F. is a public company. For the smaller brands, the up and coming people, when they want to test out this channel, when you mentioned about partnering, I assume yeah. bigger corporation can pay the influencers, but like for the smaller brands or like the up and coming people, how should they implement that strategy when they don't have that capital?
I would say, you know, there's many people. And don't be afraid to reach out and just say, hey, I thought you were doing this and you do such a great job. Are there things that would you be willing to have a conversation? So mm-hmm. it's not about always paying them. It's about building that relationship and putting yourself out there. I don't know this. How do you do this? Can I learn? Would you be comfortable in teaching me one or two things or tips? So I think networking is the thing that new entrepreneurs should sort of become really comfortable with mm-hmm. is network with the people, join those groups, join, you know, the LinkedIn group or the community groups and follow mm-hmm. the brands that inspire you. Because mm-hmm. if you follow them, then you'll see, okay, what are they doing? What are they getting into? So I would say mm-hmm. because you don't have the capital, you're going to have to be a hustler and you're going to have to build those relationships and you're going to have to, and sometimes just ask. There's a lot of good in the world. And oftentimes we assume that, you know, somebody's going to tell me a no. It's okay. If they tell you no, try again. Don't take no for an answer.
yeah, totally. I love the spirit. You mentioned about one of your favorite brands is Stitch Fix because they're good at like listening to their customers. And curious, what do you think they were doing right? What kind of trend all the e-commerce or like, retail business can learn from you guys and learn from like brands that you like?
Yeah, I would say there's so much. First of all, it's women owned, right? Like I'm just such a sucker for that. And when I see female leaders, you know, just getting out there, that's like one thing why I'm so inspired by them. But the personalization, they do the personalization better than anybody else that I've seen in e-commerce, and they continue to evolve that, right? So I do think that that's one of the reasons. From a trend perspective, I would say there is three things that I would leave people with. One is, build something that's going to allow you to gather more consumer data, build a relationship directly with your consumer, because there's a lot of privacy changes and things that are happening that are going to impact how you reach those consumers. So how do you, build that ecosystem? The second one is going to be content is king. Have a content supply chain that's going to serve all these unique consumers in different ways. So I would say invest in ways to speed that and your content supply chain. And the third is get ready to take some risks, right? Like it's okay if something is new and you've never done it before. Partner with people that might not have a big client list initially, because both of you can learn from each other. So I would say those are some of my tips that I would leave for entrepreneurs or businesses that are trying to get into this world.
Absolutely. So I love that. And then we have a 1 minute fire round for you.
Okay, sure.
So first of all, what's your favorite book?
My favorite book would be, oh my God, this is I should have this ready. But right now, one that I love is like Home. So it's by Rupi, who's like a poet. There's little snippets of poetry in there. So I love that.
Who made the biggest impact in your career?
My mom. My mom was a, yeah. So I would say just my mom, because it's
Who would you invite to your dinner party?
Oh, Michelle Obama.
Nice. Where can we find you outside of work?
At home, making my favorite food.
What's your favorite food?
Oh my God. It's this little bowl of lentils and rice that I ate as a kid. And that's what I love.
I have one last question for you. What's your favorite e.l.f. product?
Putty primer. So I use that every single day. E.l.f. putty primer is my favorite go-to product.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Ekta, for coming on the show today.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate that.
All right. That's all we have for today. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of Smart Venture Podcast. If you like it, please leave us a quick review and hit subscribe so you don't miss any tips from the experts. If you want to receive our updates, please leave your email at smartventurepod.com. If you want to connect with me, all my socials are gracegonggg, beside LinkedIn, it's just gracegong. I'd love to connect with you and let me know your thought about the show. Now you can also listen to Smart Venture Podcast on YouTube. Go to smartventurepod.com, click the YouTube link on the top banner. Don't forget to hit subscribe and smash the like button. See you next time.